Okay, so you have the Big Bang Theory. The idea that the universe started from a sub-Planck length and an explosion ensued, and all of a sudden, billions of years later, we're all here. Well, the question is, when scientists measure this event in time value, they measure the first millionth of a second after the Big Bang, they measure the first hundred thousandths of a second, and all the way to the first second and beyond, as if somebody was watching. If there were no organic life forms at the time of the Big Bang, was there a consciousness? Was the universe self-aware? Did the universe itself see the Big Bang? Did it hear it? Did it feel it? And if there was nobody there, then how could it have happened? The big question is about the Big Bang. Was there the big consciousness first? Did anybody see it? And if this consciousness saw it then and experienced the Big Bang, then where is this consciousness today? Are there fields of awareness in the fabric of space itself? Is there consciousness beyond the physical? Is this the secret to enlightenment? And can scientists verify that the field of awareness actually exists and pre-existed the Big Bang? Billion people, one planet, one global consciousness. Why do we experience suffering? Why is there war? What is our true potential to become enlightened, individually and as a civilization? What was the fall from grace? How do we become free again? Over 9 million people worldwide are incarcerated in prisons. 3.3 billion of the world's populations live in cities, geometrically designed to serve and to enslave us in perpetual debt and inflation economics. The question is there a matrix? Is there a proverbial prison for our minds? What is the matrix? In mathematics, it is a rectangular array of numbers considered as a single entity. A matrix is distinguished by the number of rows and columns it contains. A building, house, or city. The deeper level of the matrix is that we are the matrix. It is a simulation created by the architect of our minds to entertain us while we suffer. All that we know as real is actually a simulation of reality, our inner reality. The real question is, how do we attain freedom from the matrix, transform our minds, and attain liberation? Every time a home doubles in price, people have to drive their cars twice as much to make more money to pay for it. In 1988, as a nation, Americans drove 1.5 trillion miles. By 2007, that figure has doubled to nearly 3 trillion miles per year. That means doubling greenhouse gas emissions, air pollution, oil production, and more wars are fought over oil. Everything costs more, and inflation chases the proverbial rabbit. Is there a prison for our minds? Today, human beings suffer from more and more depression than at any other time in our history. According to the World Health Organization, heart disease is the number one cause of death in the world, killing over 7.2 million people per year. In the United States of America, there were 1.4 billion prescriptions for antidepressants. Millions of those were for children under the age of 18. The numbers of severely depressed human beings goes far beyond those that are taking medication for it. 1 million people worldwide commit suicide every year. What is the answer to our total freedom? Is the answer hidden deep inside of the mystical experience? Is the answer to our enlightenment available now? Over 2000 BC, Judaism begins with the covenant between God and Abraham. Its lineage goes back even farther to the time of Genesis, of Adam and Eve, the birth of humanity. Before 2200 BC, Krishna, the Hindu incarnation of God, taught the way to total freedom from suffering and the attainment of a non-dual reality filled with inner bliss and inner realization. By 1500 to 1200 BC, the Hindu Vedic teachings began, giving the foundations for perpetual liberation through the deep science of mantra, sound, and the true nature of the mind and God. In the 6th century BC, Pythagoras taught a lineage of an awakening of intelligence, enlightenment, that influenced many of the great mystics and scholars, from Plato to Socrates, creating the foundations of the true democratic and evolved political processes. In the 6th century BC, Gautama the Buddha's first words upon attaining nirvana while sitting under the Bodhi tree in deep meditation was, "There is suffering." He then taught an eightfold path that leads to the cessation and transcendence of suffering by attaining enlightenment. For those who attain it, they become Buddhas, Tathagatas, are fully enlightened ones. In the Common Era, Jesus and his mother Mary taught a way to end violence, attain the kingdom of heaven within, and wipe every tear from every eye. For his saints, such as Saint Teresa of Avila, Bernadette of Lourdes, Francis of Assisi, Dante Alighieri, Emanuel Swedenborg, there was the attainment of enlightenment. For his faithful followers, there is the bountiful new paradise earth. Today, global destruction of the ecology, war, disease, death, oppression, depression, and enlightenment all exist at the same time. Humanity now faces a critical juncture. What if it can attain enlightenment individually, one light bulb at a time? What if humanity can survive all of the challenges it faces and live in an age of sustainability? What if humanity, with the awakening of deeper intelligence and enlightenment, can advance science to the point that it can enter an interstellar community and meet with other civilizations? What have we lost by turning our backs away from the deep mystical teachings, practices, and experience inside of all of our own religions? Can it help guide us to an awakening of intelligence, to end war, depression, disease, and help guide us on our journey towards a new civilization? Considering global warming, sewage pollution, and the inconvenient truth of Al Gore, you know, the proof that we may be heading towards a mass extinction event through either global warming causing an ice age, or two, global warming causing massive virus outbreaks, what is the Tibetan Buddha's view on an exodus from a planet? If we destroy this planet and we are psychologically and ecologically involved in its destruction, where do 6.5 billion souls go from Tibet? You know, where do they find a new home if they seek reincarnation? And
well, first of all, from the point of view of the Buddhists, the planet is not destroyed. Even though we're trashing it, we will come to our senses, and they predict, and it will not be destroyed. We may go through more hardships and so on, but a total ice age or a total meltdown or a nuclear holocaust is not going to happen according to their predictions. That doesn't mean that's so, but I mean that's what they think. So that's point one. I always thought, ever since the Death Star incident in Star Wars, where Obi-Wan and Luke are flying somewhere and then there's a shudder and a disturbance in the Force, because the Death Star has actually destroyed a particular planet with many billions of souls on it. And Obi-Wan shudders, you know. But I always thought that in the Buddhist cosmology, there's billions and trillions and countless numbers of planets with humanoid beings on them. We've been on many other planets many times.
Oh, wow.
We will be on many other planets many other times. And we will, therefore, all the souls, if a whole planet was destroyed in a supernova Death Star, the souls would be reborn other places. And we ourselves have been through many big bangs and big crunches, all beings, because life is beginningless from the point of view of the Buddhists. And so there's always more places to live. However, the sort of archangels, if you could say, the bodhisattvas, you know, the compassionate beings who are making a huge effort, although they didn't create the world, they don't create and they don't control people absolutely. On a relative sense, they're quite powerful in their trying to arrange circumstances for living beings to be optimal for them to become, to wake up and become themselves bodhisattvas and become enlightened. So from a Buddhist point of view, they will do a lot in their power, and they do have considerable power to prevent us from destroying ourselves. In other words, the way we behave as human beings, our governments and everything, and our chauvinistic, especially male chauvinistic habits, having had nuclear weapons now for over 50 years, that we haven't killed each other totally or had a nuclear holocaust is itself a miracle. Mm-hmm. And the Tibetan Buddhists would argue this miracle is not really a miracle, it is the miraculous activity of enlightened angelic beings, but not an omnipotent, they don't believe in an omnipotent deity that absolutely controls everything, because then you'd have to blame the bad situation on that deity,
oh, and God,
they think that's illogical, yeah. That's very irrational. But that there are these powerful angelic forces seeing to it that we continue to learn our lessons, that we use this theater of life to evolve in the optimal, you know, mostly rapid way toward our enlightenment. That is what the Mahayana Buddhists would believe.
You know, when you read mystical experiences, it appears it's far out there, it's so difficult to achieve, it's somewhere in a distant world. But you know, when it comes to you as an experience, it is so real, it's so real. It's such a simple and practical thing to be in. There is one rule for those who go into deep experiences of samadhi, that they are not supposed to share it with others. You know the reason? Because the student then starts imagining that type of state or start craving for that state. And that craving for a particular experience becomes an impediment in getting that experience.
There are many stories of enlightenment. You see yourself on flowers. You hear your voice on trickling sound or chirping birds or winds, or you see yourself outside of you. Mm-hmm. That is moment of enlightenment. Mm-hmm. You don't belong to this body and mind.
We have all the major religions in the world share their near-death experiences with it at some point or another, including atheists, including people with no religion. It's true, even atheists, even people who absolutely profess no belief in God whatsoever can have near-death experiences. And when atheists have near-death experiences, they're just like the near-death experiences of everybody else. They're positive, blissful, have the same sequence of elements. Of course, for atheists, after they have this type of near-death experience, it's almost impossible for them to continue to be atheists. Time and time again, we've had people that will say, hey, I was an atheist, I had this near-death experience, and wow, I had to change my beliefs. Now I understand there is a higher power, I understand there is a God, I understand there's an afterlife, I understand there's much, much more to my consciousness than I ever realized, and it's almost impossible for someone to continue to cling to those atheist beliefs after they've had such a profound experience as a near-death experience.
And I was sitting in my old house in Redondo Beach on the couch, just sort of by myself, not doing much of anything, just sort of thinking. And I looked up towards our stairs, and I saw, it was the most kind of amazing thing I'd ever seen, it would be as if there was a dimensional warp or something open, there was like a sparkling. And then out of that sparkling appeared my father. But he was in his absolute prime. He passed away when he was 79. In this vision, he was maybe 35 to 38, something like that, and smiling and grinning. And I could see, I sort of went with the experience because I was so shocked that I saw him. I could see through him, and yet it was there. So it was obviously an apparition of some sort. I mean, it was his spirit, yet he was very real, and I could certainly make out that it was him, and had the whole, you know, his whole body actually appeared. And as he kind of floated down the stairs towards me, I'm in shock, and I go, Dad? And he goes, you were right, you big stinker. And I laughed. And what that was in relationship to is over the years, we'd had an ongoing debate about life after death. And my own experience was, and my belief was, that there is more to life and that the spirit certainly survives the shell of the body. And he was very agnostic at best, if not an atheist, and said, nah, I don't believe any of it. You know, when you're dead, you're dead. And he comes over and he basically sits down at the other end of the couch. And I'm, you know, going with this, not believing that it's actually happening, and yet it's happening. And we then, in the next half hour or so, time kind of stopped. I don't really know how long it was, but it seemed like, you know, not enough time. And yet we were able to, I was able to tell him all of my hurts and things that we didn't experience and how come you did certain things. And he was able to tell me, you know, that he was sorry and how much he had loved me. And, you know, it was the kind of intimacy and exchange, I might get tears in my eyes again, where he opened in a way that he could never do when we were alive. We never had this kind of an experience. And right at the key moment where I really felt a sense of love and companionship with him that I'd never felt, he started to fade away. He started to like sort of move up into the air. And I go, Dad, and I was crying. I said, Dad, don't go, don't go. And he continued to move up and I'm watching him go up. And that same kind of a sparkling thing happened like I saw at the top of the stairs originally. And as he was kind of fading away and moving towards the ceiling, he said, Michael, remember, I'm only a thought away. I'm only a thought away. And then the last one sort of faded out. He goes, I'm only a thought away. He went out through the ceiling and then the sparkling stopped.
And here we are as a biological system, relatively tiny, on a relatively tiny planet, in a relatively tiny solar system, in a relatively tiny galaxy, compared to the scope of the universe that we can see through telescopes. And yet, this mind that exists in our individual consciousnesses, in each and every one of us, this mind has the capability to envision things as tiny as superstrings and go from the micro, up through atoms and molecules and cells and organs and people and planets and solar systems and universes. And literally we could imagine ourselves holding ourselves, envisioning the consciousness of everything. And the conclusion I come to is that our minds are bigger than the entire universe. Our minds, our consciousness has the capability to go from the small to the all. And that capability exists in every one of us. The question is, will we tap into it? Will we develop the skills to be able to go from the micro to the macro? Will we develop the skills to be able to integrate all this information? And that's where the developing the tools of consciousness becomes part of our great challenge.
And he had been saving them for, well, he had met Kripal Singh in India 25 years earlier when Kripal Singh gave these to him. And so apparently this food is blessed and it holds some example of, or it there's a spiritual energy put into this food or any article, I believe, and they call it Parshad. So the idea is if you eat this stuff, you'll get a spiritual experience that somewhat, I don't even know the intention. I guess the intention is to encourage you to believe that there's a spiritual dimension and this is some benefit to you. So he offers me these grains, this one grain of rice that he's been saving for 25 years. And we're sitting in his kitchen in Santa Cruz, California. And it was rather instantaneous. He and I were both seated at the same table, and it seemed as though, no, it didn't seem. My consciousness moved beyond my body, and it went beyond the kitchen we were in, and it went beyond the house we were in. And it was very strange because, you know, this part of me that I identify as myself, like right here in this chair, literally seemed to be, you know, go beyond this, like this vase over here. Like I really felt like I was that vase. You know, here's my arm, that's definitely me, but now it was like that vase was me too. And then beyond that, and I was becoming the walls in the building, and then I was becoming the buildings beyond the building. And it was really frightening. It was very frightening. And it kept going. and it went through the whole city, and I kind of had the idea of what was in the city. Like, I mean, this sounds insane. But anyway, it went beyond the city, it went beyond the world, and then I felt as though I was going into space, and my consciousness was expanding through space. Now, this sounds crazy, of course, but nevertheless, I got the idea of inhabited worlds in space, what they were like, and this idea of the volume and vastness of space that I'd never been able to comprehend before this time. It was absolutely terrifying. And it just kept going. So this kept happening. We're expanding out into space for, I guess, maybe 40 minutes. And we're clutched onto the corner of the kitchen table. We're seated at the table, and our arms are wrapped around this table, holding on for dear life. I don't know what that means, but and tears are dripping from our eyes to, you know, to the table, both he and I. And I'm saying, "Are you experiencing the same thing?" He's over there nodding, he can't really speak. And we are just going, "Please, we can't take it anymore. Please turn this off." And we're believing Kirpal Singh is a real entity. I mean, you got the idea. I mean, It was clear that Kirpal Singh was responsible for this. It was though he was an entity who was right there taking you on this journey. And, you couldn't see him. There was just, the presence of him was very real. And so anyway, essentially we were just begging for him to turn it off, because we thought we were going to die. I mean, that was the idea. It's just, you can't survive this kind of experience without some trouble.
So I think we need to preface that we were going through a transformational change at that point, and we had started seeing flashes of light, the experience that I had had in my living room where I was reading the magazine, and we had a two-way fireplace. I was in one living room, and the fireplace also was two-way into the other living room, and all the lights were off in the house except for my reading lamp, and it was late at night, and I was flipping through the magazine, and through this time, I had was asking to see the angels. I always had a lot of faith and prayer and was doing healings, but I wanted to see them. And so I was one evening, I was flipping through, just thinking about the kids and when I was going to get them, and then I just felt this presence. And I slowly looked over to my shoulder through the fireplace, and this amazing flash of blue-white light, like lightning bolts, or like about 50 light bulbs went off in the other living room and just flashed through the entire house. And from that point on, the kids have started seeing the flashes of light, and then we moved to Scottsdale, and that's when they were experiencing the balls of light, and we started having more visions of angels. So what color was the ball of light?
Mostly white with a splash of gold. But what's really strange about it is that if I would have something blocking my view, I'd usually get really irritated, but it was more calming than ever.
What would get irritated?
Like, I'd be watching TV, then Alex would go in front of the TV, and I'd sort of get mad, but it would sort of be, see, I'd look at maybe a chair or something, and the light would be in front of it, and I couldn't really see it, but it wouldn't bother me. It was calming.
Oh, so it irritated you if something got in front of the ball?
No.
The ball got
in front. No, he's saying normally if Alex got in front of the TV, that would irritate him, but the balls of white didn't irritate you.
Yeah.
Okay.
It made
Mother
So centering. They were very calming.
They're very centering.
They had a presence.
Very centering, he said.
Yeah.
You felt a presence with these balls of white.
Oh, yes.
How big were they? Describe with your hands.
Like
that. Wow.
That's big.
It's pretty big.
And there were gold and white light.
Yeah.
And do you believe other people could see these, or do you think you're seeing into the invisible where other people don't see?
I don't know. I mean, I know there are people more spiritual than me, like the monks, and maybe they see them, or I don't really know. I mean, I'm pretty sure that I'm seeing something invisible to the most human.
So, Alexander, why don't you tell about the bubbles of light that both you and Adam see, but you would see the bubbles all the time. She would always go to bed and say, "I see the bubbles around me."
Wherever I look, and if I close my eyes and open them, I'll see, like, a bubble or a zigzag of different colors, red, blue, the rainbow colors. And if it's really dark, I'll see a ton of little bubbles like that big, and they'll be all over the place just floating around.
Wow! I'm really blown away. I want to see those bubbles. Actually, only one time in my life I saw bubbles, and that's when I was hypothermic.
Okay, first of all, let's talk about what do we mean by invisible, and then we'll address this to the question of apparitions and spirits and all other forms of, quote, invisible beings. Mm-hmm. What science has taught us, which I find to be utterly extraordinary, is that our visual experience, which is totally brilliant, only sees a tiny sliver of all the vibrations of photons that exist in the known universe. So, if I look outdoors, for example, and I can see tens of thousands of rocks and tens of thousands of leaves and hundreds of thousands of hues of colors and shapes and sizes, it can fill my consciousness, my visual consciousness, with all these details. And yet all that complexity and all that experience is more than, I don't explain how tiny the sliver is. Let me give you an example of how little we see. If we imagine the size of the Empire State Building as reflecting all the known frequencies of light that exists in this room right now, and then we ask, how much of those vibrations can we see with our naked eye? Okay? Do we see 50 stories, 10 stories worth of the vibration, 1 story of the vibration, 1 foot of the vibration? What science tells us is the amount that we see in our consciousness is smaller than the grain of sand. So what we are seeing with all this breath is a grain of sand compared to the Empire State Building of vibration, of light. So most things that exist are, quote, invisible to us. Our senses are extraordinarily limited. Our normal senses are extraordinarily limited. But we can go beyond those senses when we develop certain higher forms of awareness and consciousness. We can also do it with science. In fact, what science can be thought of is the process of making the invisible visible. We take frequencies we cannot see, and then we transform them. We either increase them or decrease them and put them into the little grain of sand of the spectrum that we can see. And now all of a sudden we can see the invisible with technology. So once you become aware that most of what exists is invisible, and it's all light. It's all light. We're talking about just the vibrations of photons here. Then the idea that there could be apparitions, or there could be angels, or there could be any number of beings or processes that are not part of our everyday experience becomes extraordinarily plausible. We just have to then use our technology and apply it to these processes, these questions, these beings. And that's what's happening now in science. We're beginning to take this supersensitive technology, develop for other purposes, and we're applying it to these other realms.
But if I'm sleeping, I can go into like a different state of consciousness where I'll like wake up, but I won't, my body won't be awake, and I can see like people sitting on my bed. And it always depends on what state I'm in as well, or what types of energies I'm attracting to me. Now that I'm working on a clearer energy, I usually attract guides and things like that who can communicate to me through the night. Okay, so my aunt, actually it happened when I was 19 years old. I'd been seeing like spirits on and off as a child, but never really taking it seriously. But when I was about 19 years old, my aunt had died probably 4 years before that, but I was going through a tough stage and I was looking for a transition. And one night I was asleep and my body was paralyzed, obviously, because your body goes into that state sometimes when you sleep. And then I must have just been drifting off, and it was like my astral body sat up out of my body, and I remember looking down and seeing my body down there. And then there was a lady sitting on my windowsill, and she was a lot younger, and I didn't communicate verbally to her, but it was a telepathic thing. I could tell that, you know, I was connected with her thoughts and she was connected with mine. And I said to her in my thoughts, "Who are you?" And as soon as I said that, I got a flash of my auntie when she was about 83 years old. I think that was the age when she died. And then I knew that it was her. So I started saying, you know, "Why are you here? What do you need to give me a message?" And she just started to telepathically tell me that everything's okay and you need to move to Sydney, which was across the other side of the country. And there had been a few thoughts coming into my mind about wanting to move and needing a transition because I felt really stuck. But because I was so young, it was really hard to make such a decision to move across country. So she kind of came to me and she guided me a little bit. And then I just laid back in my body and I woke up the next morning and I remembered it all so vividly. And that sort of made me make that grounded decision. And then I left probably about 6 months later.
So how did it affect you to see someone? I mean, did it confirm for you that we live on to see someone that was your own relative?
Yeah, definitely. And a lot of people are skeptic out there because maybe they haven't had the experience. And I think as a child, I had a lot of those types of experiences. But because older people and parents and things like that, it's not really the thing to believe. I kind of shut it out. But having a deep experience like that and seeing my auntie come to me and actually being able to come out of my body and for it to be so real just really reconfirmed it in my mind.
Yes, when I was little, when we first moved into Arizona, I put my hand down by a lizard and the lizard just crawled onto me. And I just like animals a lot, and I like to save their lives sometimes.
What do you think of Nua?
She's cute.
She's really happy with you. She looks all blissed out. So Alex, you just saw a man in our house?
Yep. Outside the bathroom window.
Right, he was outside the house?
Yeah.
Can you show me, walk with me and show me where...
Did he appear and disappear, or...?
No, I just saw him. See that big bush right there?
Yeah.
The big giant, he was sitting right under it.
Under the tree?
Yeah.
Right to the right?
It was all the way up there.
All the way there. Wow. So you're drawing a picture of him that you just saw him.
Okay, let's go look at your picture that you're gonna draw.
Yeah, I'm getting goosebumps like crazy. Look at me.
Come on, my goosebumps.
Oh, you are. I can go get some. I really would
have. I've got goosebumps.
Teacher,
you draw feet.
I felt a very native Indian presence. The last time we were up in Sedona.
Is there a way for people, I mean, these invisible cities like Shambhala, I mean, again, when the mind is pure, do they actually see
Shambhala? Is not a city. Shambhala supposedly is a country with 96 million inhabitants.
Wow.
Near the North Pole, somewhere like in the North Pole area, surrounded by all kind of rows of ice mountains, and with a force field that covers it that makes it invisible. But it's a huge country, and they have 96 provinces, each one with a million citizens, and 96 capitals. The central one, Kalapa, is there. I mean, in the legend of Shambhala, that's what Shambhala is. Not like one city.
Right.
That's like a confusion. You know? So it's not in the Gobi and all that. It's a confusion. It's somewhere like in the north of Mongolia, therefore in the North Pole area.
So, yeah,
no, Shambhala is up there in about 400 years. Apparently the veil is lifted and we see Shambhala. And then the Shambhalans kind of help us out and get us past our phase of militarism. And then the Dharma becomes very widespread for about 1,800 years, supposedly.
300 or 400 you said from now?
Yeah, 300 or 400 years from now.
From now, Shambhala will reveal itself.
Yeah.
That's...
And then it interacts, you know, there's a little bit of a buffeting, a little bit of a...
That's incredible.
...bit of a scrap. And then, like an Armageddon type of scrap. But then basically the whole planet goes toward peace, and there's a golden age of 1800 years, they say. But I can't imagine that it would be only 1800 years, but maybe. And there's a very golden age of people being very loving and developing wisdom, a lot of education, a lot of meditation, and a lot of spirituality and way past violence, equality of the genders, you know, the sexes, male and female, no more male dominated, but also no female dominated, but equality. And a really wonderful era, they believe, will ensue at that time. And I'm always protesting with the Tibetans that I think their calculations are wrong, because I don't think the planet can last that long under the present stress of militarism and exploitation, and that it should, they're either they're hiding the true calculation or the calculation
should
is
be
off.
Sooner.
And it should be sooner, I feel, but personally, but that's just my own, you know, they just laugh when I say that. Dalai Lama actually says that he doesn't believe in it at all, that he's not into prophecies, that people should live according to their practice that they can do right then and there, shouldn't sit waiting for something to happen.
Right,
and that's what he likes to say. And in another sense, there's a few stray theories that actually Shambhala's already here, and it's a matter of turning your awareness. Mm-hmm. And then you just don't even notice all these morons running around shooting each other.
Well, essentially what happens is your spirit does, you find yourself cooking through some last edges of resistance. You find yourself becoming so present in this very moment. You're so inside of your body. You're so dealing with any edges of resistance that you might be feeling somewhere in your energy system. And by surrendering deeply into it, by going into it as opposed to skipping out and avoiding it in some way, by going right through the core of your last resistances, it's like suddenly you feel all of your energy almost like releasing and expanding. And you know, my experiences often have been through the third eye, where there's like last areas of resistance, and the energy just, you know, it kind of like it burns through there, and suddenly there's an expansion, and you realize that, oh my God, more of me is outside of my body than is in my body, yet you are simultaneously in your body. And you have the peculiar sensation of being in a place of singularity where there are no boundaries.
And I did my first 3-day intensive Buddhist retreat where you sit. We had, you know, all these people, like 20 or 30 people in our house, and my dad led this retreat, and you sat cross-legged, back straight, 1 hour at a time, 5-minute break, 1 hour at a time, 5-minute break. And by the end of the day, you're meditating 12 hours. I mean, I've climbed mountains, I have skied down, you know, 55 degree slopes, I've jumped off 30 foot cliffs, I've planted trees for 22 years, and I'm telling you, there's nothing harder than sitting in this posture, cross-legged with, you know, the hands folded, and the legs crossed, back straight, with not leaning against the wall, sitting for 12 hours a day. It is the hardest thing I've ever done. And it's not only physically challenging to hold that posture for so many hours a day, but it's mentally challenging just to stare into my mind and my thoughts and my emotions all day long with no distractions, no TV, no phones, very little food, and just doing that. And we did this for 3 days. On the second day of the retreat, I mean, my legs were shaking. I couldn't even sit properly. I mean, my legs were bent upwards and I was shaking. My eyes and my back was hurting. And all of a sudden, you know, after hours of boredom and just staring at this opaque nothingness and the breath and watching the breath and doing this technique called insight meditation, all of a sudden, you know, in my belly, you know, right down in here, there was this just cracking explosion of ecstasy. I mean, it was so bright. It happened so fast, and I just started bursting out laughing hysterically. And I would fight and try to stop, you know, laughing, because there were all these people in the meditation room. And pretty soon I started laughing so hard I just had to leave. I had to get up and go outside. And when I walked outside, it was like I didn't even have a body anymore. I mean, I had the arms and the legs, and I could walk, but I was in this ethereal space. And I remember walking through this grassy field in the park in Vancouver, Canada,
and I came upon these three weeping willow trees with blowing in the wind. And when the wind blew through the trees, I was the tree. I was the wind caressing the tree. I could feel it, just like I can feel my face and my eyes and my skin. I could actually feel it. I was in this extended consciousness. And not only that, there was this supernatural ecstasy bathing the trees. And it just seemed to get deeper and deeper and deeper. I got so lost in these trees. And I remember these birds, these crows walking on the grass, and it tickled me when they walked on the grass because they were walking on me. It's like I was that connected to the whole. And all of a sudden, that this vast consciousness, this beautiful, peaceful ecstasy, it was not like an exhilarating kind of a high. It was this smooth ecstasy. All of a sudden, I could hear what the Hindus call the sound of Om, the all-pervading sound of the universe. I could hear every plant, every tree, every blade of grass, every unique plant had its own sound. And the sound was very silent, but very obvious in this consciousness. And it with all the sounds of all living things were blending into this symphony of the sound of Om. And I looked up, I remember looking up and looking up at the sun, and I was just in awe. I was like, oh my God, I can hear the sun. The sun was making this very high-pitched frequency sound combined with a very low-frequency sound together. And it was also in the symphony of Om, and the sound of everything was merging. And I walked, and it just felt like I was made of pure consciousness. I was no longer the body.
In the 6th century BC, Pythagoras taught that a harmonic sound was produced from the motion of the celestial bodies. The sun, the planets, and the stars in the heavens were producing a sort of cosmic music as they pulse from within and travel along the vibrating strings of their orbits. Pythagoras actually experienced going beyond his physical boundaries with his consciousness and hearing what is now called the music of the spheres. He believed anyone who purified their senses could have this experience. Quote, "Such a one will perceive things invisible to others and will hear things inaudible by others." With this enlightenment and wisdom, Pythagoras gave birth to classical music and the intervallic system we use to write music today. He saw three phases of music: the musica humana, the music of the human being as the human instrument, the music instrumentalis, the music of the voice and musical instruments, and the Musica Mundana, the music of the cosmos. The human musical body and mind is an instrument which, if tuned and purified, could expand its awareness into the world and cosmic beyond.
I thought I was seeing my scuba diving bubbles. I thought I was seeing from the mask and from the tank. I thought I was seeing the bubbles, and they were beautiful. They were soap bubbles like, and I was moving with these incredible bubbles, moving so fast, and as I was moving with these bubbles, I kept thinking, well, somebody's saving me. I'm being saved, and I move with these bubbles, and I could see in front of me, I could see behind me, I could see on top of me, left of me, and the right of me. And all of a sudden, I realized I couldn't see my body. I couldn't see my body. There was no body. I was a bubble. I must have been a bubble. I was a spirit. I was moving with these bubbles, and I was a light. And these lights were like diamonds, all sides. They were a kaleidoscope of colors, of beautiful, soapy bubbles. And as we moved, as the speed quieted down, almost Tai Chi slowed down. Time stopped. It slowed down too. And there was no beginning and there was no end. I was in the now. And the now had a voice. The now had energy. The now was orgasmic in quality. It was brilliantly, orgasmically gorgeous, exploding. Voices of beauty, of grace, of love. Billions and billions of voices, and it sang, and I was singing. I was vibrating in this energy. I was vibrating, and I was singing my song. I was singing all the things that I had experienced in body that were beautiful. And as the energy passed through me and vibrated from me like a tuning fork, I was singing my melody, and the melody was part of heaven's melody and part of heaven's light.
Asking what it feels like when I sing is actually the one question that doesn't mean anything. Because the whole point of chanting, and I guess spiritual practice in general, is to engage yourself completely in the practice. There's no one there to be evaluating or thinking about it or saying, wow, this is really good, or this is bad, or I should try harder, or anything like that. You reach a certain point where you're given 100%. And at that point, there's nobody left. There's no part of you left to be noticing how it feels at the time.
Well, if we are exclusively content in ourselves, that is total life, total value of your life. Your body and mind is yourself. But if you really achieve anatta, if you really see yourself outside of your body, you are released from this clumsy body and mind. That is a real achievement.
The human aura is our very own glowing, living energy field that extends beyond our physical boundaries. While invisible to most humans, it is a light extension of our soul. In rare cases of enlightened individuals, such as Krishna and Radha, Buddha, Kuan Yin, Jesus, Mary, and other enlightened beings or saints, it was said that you could actually see a huge luminous sphere, nimbus, or halo expanding beyond their head region. People were so affected by the divine presence of these masters that when coming in contact with their aura, enlightenment was transmitted through it as they felt the presence of God. What about ordinary human beings? Do we have our own halo or aura? The human aura is comprised as a single large halo or sphere that extends beyond the human body. Its components are made up of 7 primary energy centers. The first, being the root or sex energy center, is symbolized by the color red and is located near the tailbone. Second is the life force connector, symbolized by the color orange, and located just below the navel or belly button. The third is the doer or motivator energy center, symbolized by the color yellow and located just below the sternum or heart center. The fourth is our heart, symbolized by the color green. This is our love center. Fifth is our throat, symbolized by the color blue. This is our communication center. The sixth energy center is symbolized by the color violet. Located in the middle of our forehead, it is the inner eye or inner vision center. The seventh energy center is located at the crown of the head and is symbolized by white. It is our universal connector center. All of these energy centers correspond to our physiological organs and our vital and subtle energies. While scientific studies of human consciousness in the past have been limited to brain wave mapping with EEGs and brain scanning with magnetic resonance imaging, Curlian photography was the first breakthrough to demonstrate that we could actually take a photograph of the human aura. Amazing colors could be seen radiating from human fingertips, leaves, and other organic life forms, proving that all living things have energy fields or auras. Today, the world's first 3D human aura imaging camera and computer technology has emerged as a revolution in the field of consciousness studies. Internationally distinguished physicist Professor Konstantin Korotkov from St. Petersburg Tech University in Russia developed a way to not only see the aura of the human organism, plants, and organic life forms, but to also see the real detailed data and information contained in the aura's energy field. This represents an incredible and exciting breakthrough. This revolutionary camera and computer software captures the biophotons, or aura, radiating off of all 10 fingertips.
And each finger rests on the electrode.
It then transposes the actual information of our aura into a 3D model composite of the entire human body. Our biophotons transmit our consciousness and information, just like voices and TV pictures are transmitted on radio and microwaves. The information in our aura can actually be captured and stored in a computer. Now we can actually measure the amplitude, balance, and integration of radiant energy radiating from all 7 human energy centers. It shows detailed data where a person is radiant or weak in their spiritual, emotional, and physical bodies.
This one's interesting. It has like a spiral coming
off. See the finger?
Oh, it's a...
Krishna Madappa, an East Indian American research partner of Dr. Koratkov, conducted an experiment designed by David Sarita with 5 meditators. The purpose of these experiments was to scientifically demonstrate how meditation could possibly change and benefit an individual's state of consciousness and raise their vibration. Krishna also decided to see if the group could affect change in the vibration, structure, coherence, and organization of water placed in a glass in front of them.
Why does it take, you know, thousands of lifetimes to become as awake as the Buddha?
That's an interesting question. Because we have so many ways to hide, so many layers to peel, you know? And society doesn't want us to be free, because if we are free, we cannot be controlled. So society does everything to stop the process of freedom in humans.
A baseline was established by taking energy readings of the water before the meditation began. The baseline begins at 10 with parameters of 10 to 1. This number represents coherency, structure, and organization of the water's energy. 10 being the least, and 1 being the highest measurable potential, as in perfect oneness. In the first test, the group participated in 45 minutes of vigorous breathing meditation that is designed to activate each of the 7 energy centers in the body and soul. The group ended with 15 minutes of silent meditation.
The Sufi breathing to me is just taking it to it's a different type of meditation. You're hyperventilating, basically you're breathing in and out, panting like a dog very, very quickly. So you're super enriching the bloodstream of the body with oxygen. So my head, at least what I felt, was I got a little bit dizzy, but it was very much, I opened up in so many ways to the point to where I began to feel like I was in a different space. And in my experience, towards the end of the Sufi breathing, it was about 45 minutes out, I had a vision that I became an eagle and that I was flying into the sun, and I could literally feel the rays of the sun, the yellow rays of the sun, impacting my body. And I was flying along, I could feel the wind under my wings. It was really different. I had no idea I'd ever expect anything like this or experience anything like this. But it was really, really good. And then after we did the Sufi breathing exercise, then I was tested on the GDV machine, and it showed a completely different result. My chakras had become more in line. They became larger, especially my heart chakra. I noticed that the heart chakra circle became very, very large on the computer as we viewed that.
Dr. Krishna Madappa took several readings of each of the 5 participants' energy centers and their total aura field.
We are also going to get a baseline reading of the water in a simple principle, as we have done with the electrophoton capture device. And we will do this in principle, taking 15 frames per second for a total of 10 seconds. So we will take 150 frames 5 times. Before and then after the Sufi meditation, we will again look at a similar set, and all this will be dynamical images of the water, at which point in time, once we open it up in the program called the Scientific Laboratory Program, then we can see clearly influence how the water's area, entropy, fractality, intensity, all has contributed before and after.
I met an Undamayma when I was very young. And then I was away from her for a long, long time. And then I saw her again when she was a little older. And she was completely merged with everything. She was, how can I, you know, it's, words can't describe who she was, who she is.
Yeah, Mukti, that's her, that's not her baseline.
This is Muktima after Sufi breathing.
Yeah.
And you can
look at her heart chakra.
Yeah, you can, on one hand, for Muktima, it is really strong when she is in active mode. Which is why you also relish dancing,
yes.
The African dance. That dynamical mode for you is very present.
He then took several readings of the water's energy. Amazing results ensued. The average energy coherency, structure, and organization of the water improved by 20% in just 1 hour of meditation, registering from a baseline of 10 and progressing to 8. In the second meditation, the group chanted the word Om for 30 minutes. This meditation is designed to bring harmony to the human body and mind. After this meditation, Krishna again took several readings of everyone's auras and the water's energy.
What will happen now? We must make sure that while we have Nula's nose there and...
We cover
it. Oh, look.
If not, we can just do her tail.
Her tail.
Okay, one more time, Nula, okay?
Tail, no.
Okay, one more time. Well, give me the scarf.
Okay.
Nula, this is right.
This was a study to show, is it possible to send and quantify, measure energy of healing, loving energy? Sending. So if we sent loving energy to another being who is not directly in front of you, but in another space, will they receive it? And if they receive it, how does it show?
Wow.
That was the purpose. And this was done with a team of researchers in Slovenia. So here we see that you've got the person who is sending energy. This is the right side, is sending of energy. And on this side is the receiving of energy. So from the right side, when you talk about, because the emotional heart is on the right, it is sending. So there is a little burst. And of course, these bursts are captured.
And it's separate from the body. It's leaving, this burst is leaving the body.
Indeed.
Oh, that's amazing.
And the receiver is receiving it. And look at the shape of that too.
How far away are they physically from each other during the experience?
Two buildings.
So this burst of energy traveled two buildings and went to...
this person who was the receiver.
And this is documented scientifically as biophoton emissions.
Yes, yes.
Honey, you got big chocolates.
Yes, big chocolates.
Look at the size of those things.
That's a new way to say, hey, I like your chakras. Nice. They are huge.
Look at her blue. Let me just zoom in on her blue inner eye chakra. Now look at this. It's like
that
taking up the whole head.
This is after Om.
Okay.
Yeah, so she even told me this, the gentle meditations have a more... But your inner eye chakra, your third chakra, and your crown are very... And your throat, and your heart.
Look at the strength that has gained from here up.
In the Om.
In the Om. And you had a vision.
Yeah.
You said...
she did. That's where the
tall
tear.
Shaft going out and opening into the clouds.
I had this amazing vision in my third eye, which I felt both there and above my head, a very powerful energy, and it was quite a unique experience I've never experienced before. It was really exciting when I was able to actually see it on the aura machine that my chakras that I could feel were being most activated showed on the machine as well. I mean, I was also very emotional and I couldn't help but cry, and my heart chakra all the way through to my crown chakra was very enlarged through that experience.
The average energy coherency, structure, and organization of the water had maintained a level of 8. The third meditation was a 2-hour sitting meditation. Each meditator pursued their own form of insight or sitting meditation. This is a very difficult practice.
Near the end, I mean, my body was in so much pain. My legs hurt so bad, I wanted to just move, but something allowed me just to relax even further into the pain rather than trying to escape it. And I got to this point where I opened my eyes and the sunlight coming through the windows and you know, just gracing the walls, I saw and I felt in my heart that God was in the sunlight itself. There wasn't this spiritual light in the room. There was just sunlight. But the sunlight, I was so aware that the sunlight touched me so deeply. I was moved to the most incredible motions in my heart chakra. And tears and goosebumps came for hours afterward, just in waves. I mean, it was such a deep experience to see God was in the sunlight itself.
After 2 hours of meditation, Krishna took several readings of everyone's auras and the water's energy.
What we are looking at is a dynamical image of photons and electrons cascading onto this suspended droplet.
The water's energy went from a baseline of 10 to 5.5, which means it went nearly halfway to its total potential. This was astounding. David Sarita explains.
The idea that my consciousness, that our consciousness as a group, that we affected a glass of water and we transformed its energy, its coherency and its structure, and we caused it to progress halfway to its total potential, one being the highest value, 10 being the lowest, one being the closest we can get to absolute oneness, is amazing. How did we do it? How did our brains and our state of consciousness cause the water to transform? How did it actually occur? Well, if we look at the idea that we are not just a particle, an organism, that we have this aura, this energy field. As this field extends beyond the physical boundaries, it's exchanging information with everything around it. In fact, I don't believe this is just occurring with water. Water is the easiest to see how consciousness is affecting reality, because the hydrogen and the oxygen atoms in H2O are actually the simplest structures and they're the easiest to see these effects. We're probably affecting the wood, the walls, in fact, each other, the planet even, and even beyond the planet. We're affecting everything with our consciousness. So
imagine for a moment if a hurricane was coming in the future. But now, as people, instead of what we're doing with the weather forecasts, which is we're amplifying the fear and we're looking at all the blowing of the winds and all the torment and so on. Imagine instead we had millions or billions of people simultaneously engaged in an organized, synchronized, guided imagery over the media of sending loving intentions and calming intentions to a storm, or even was redirecting it to a safer environment. Would we find that the storm was diminished? Would we find that the storm might be moved? Well, we'll never discover it unless we look for it. If we don't ask the questions and we don't try it, we'll never know whether it matters or not.
The question is, how is this actually occurring? We have to look at quantum modeling of the atom in small to see the answer. And the answer, as we look at it, was first discovered by a physicist named Walter Shemp, who in the 1990s found that atoms all around us in our bodies and in the air mass and the space are actually exchanging information with each other, having a dialogue. So the key is, how is this information propagated through the space-time medium? How is this occurring? Atoms are talking to each other and exchanging information all the time. And the way that it actually works is like this. If we look at the diameter of an electron spinning around the proton in a hydrogen atom, what physicists discovered is the electrons jump shells or wavelengths. They change wavelengths, which means they change diameter. What Niels Bohr discovered is that when electrons jump into shorter diameters, they go into a higher frequency orbit. And when they do that, the atom radiates off some of its energy in the form of a light wave, in the form of electromagnetism. And then when electrons go back to a longer wavelength, they jump back out to a greater diameter, the atom is actually receiving electromagnetism. And this has been known, you know, since the early 1900s. What Walter Shemp discovers in this process of sending out energy in the form of electromagnetism and receiving energy in the form of electromagnetism, that these transmissions and receptions were not blank. Meaning, he discovered they had intelligent information encoded in them. Which means that just like we talk on the radio and we tag the human voice onto a radio wave, which travels at the speed of light, and that we send pictures and voices on microwaves, which travel at the speed of light, which is television, that the atom was doing the same thing. That atoms are, that live in this giant, enormous, universal field of consciousness, these atoms are actually talking to each other on a regular basis. And what happens is, what Shemp discovered, and he proved this scientifically, is that when the atom is sending out a light wave, it has information and data actually tagged on to the light wave. And then when it receives a light wave, it actually is receiving not just a light wave, but actual information and data is recorded on the light wave.
Well, Walter Shemp's intelligent atom shows how communication can happen in less than a second over a small sphere of distance such as the Earth, and within minutes inside the solar system. It cannot explain how communication between two points can happen instantaneously regardless of distance in the universe, such as between galaxies millions of light years apart. But Einstein's discovery of spooky action at a distance demonstrates how consciousness can travel between two points instantaneously. This identifies a field that is able to send conscious information not only faster than light, but instantaneously over any distance. Einstein was spooked by it because no theory in physics could explain it, not even his, but they could verify that it was actually happening.
Two items are entangled when they have shared the space, become part of a system together. Most frequently it's described in an atomic scale as, let's say, two electrons in near the same space. They can't be exactly the same, so one way they're different is to have what people refer to as spin, one opposite to the other. That allows them to share the space. And this shared system is called entangled. These two items, elements, which could be two people, are entangled with each other if they share qualities of the universe in their space. And if you fall in love with somebody, you are entangled with that person. If you belong to a group that gets together and has deep, stimulating discussions, you become entangled in such a way that all of you share some aspect of the others. In any case, this kind of entanglement, even though we haven't been able to demonstrate it in strong terms in macroscopic cases like two people, it's real, demonstrable, and a function of atomic systems, and we're gradually moving toward demonstrating in laboratory experiments that it can happen at larger scale systems. It doesn't seem there should be any limit on that, so people undoubtedly can be entangled with each other.
When scientists took a mother and baby rabbit separating them over a great distance. They hook both of their brains up to EEGs and atomic clocks to measure the event. They pinpricked the baby rabbit, and the mother felt it instantaneously, not at the speed of light, which is 186,282 miles per second, but they felt it instantaneously. When Alain Aspect, the French physicist, did the same experiment by separating electron-anti-electron pairs over great distances, he found when stimulating the properties of one of the pairs, the other over a great distance would respond instantaneously. How did this happen? What conscious field is there that is beyond light speed communication and observation?
My friend Dean Radin, for example, believed that entanglement is not just for atoms, that we can have entanglement at bigger scales and ultimately at macroscopic scales, and suggests that when we are communicating in what appears to be an impossible way, using telepathy or some kind of psychic connection, that can be described and maybe accurately using the terms of entanglement.
Okay. Yes, I truly 100% believe that everyone is psychic. I think that some people have a easier time bringing out their abilities once they know the techniques and how to control them. And it really, more so than a matter of having the ability, because again, we all have it. It's more a matter of, are people disciplined enough to practice the techniques? Are they courageous enough to see what is coming in, to let themselves see the information and then to communicate it? I think some people are better suited to reading people, and when I say reading, I mean picking up information about anything from their past to present to a little bit of their future. So I think that some people are better suited to reading people, whereas other psychics are better suited to picking up information about, say, remote locations or lost objects or world events. It's just like any other skill. Some people, say, with musical talent are good at reading music. Others are good at improvising and then getting into the different styles of music. And it's the same thing with your psychic abilities. Another comparison here is that anybody has the ability to at least bang out some notes on a piano. And then there's obviously prodigies from the time that they're born. And it's really the same thing with your psychic abilities. And I'm just blown away that, both with myself, that I could have lived to almost the age of 29. And there's people who die, millions of people who die without ever really realizing the extent of their abilities. And I think that it's just so important that, for one, we get over this idea that there's only a few gifted people out there with these abilities. That's completely not true. There's, most people have them.
One of the amazing features of entanglement, and probably one of the reasons that it's so hard for many people to comprehend or believe in, is that it really goes all the way down or all the way back. So in a strong sense, the Big Bang, if that's the way the universe started, was an entangled state, and all of whatever developed after that still is entangled. This implies, even if it's not true in complete detail, the model suggests that we are entangled with each other, even at huge distances. Coming down to Earth, so to speak, I think it means without much question that there is a little bit of entanglement present in the relationships of everybody on the planet. So it shouldn't be very surprising when we discover that a big event in the world, like the tragedy of 9/11, causes very, very large numbers of people to think about the same kind of thing, increase their entanglement, and result in a measure on our random event system, which we haven't talked about in detail yet, but we probably should.
Is there a God consciousness field? It's remarkable if we consider the Bible book of Genesis in the first and second verses, that God is actually creating the universe and the earth by moving God's spirit over the face of water. If a small group of human brains can affect the structure of water, scientifically demonstrated, then perhaps we can understand how God, the overall consciousness of the universe, created the universe and the earth and the planets the same way, just on a grander scale. But if we are affecting water and everything around us all the time with our consciousness, what will happen when we become a mature and singular civilization? What kind of power will we possess then?
We may be inadvertently affecting all kinds of events, from weather, through growth, through literally how people are behaving. If you have 500 million people having a hatred for another group of people, that summated intention and energy, if you follow just where our research is going, our lab and other labs, leads us to the conclusion that we are going to be having these synergistic effects, that we're all interconnected through our consciousness and our energy. And so therefore, we need to become conscious of this, and then we need to be able to transform our consciousness so we can take more responsibility for the effects that we're having on everything else in our environment.
One time you said to me, there is no universe outside this mind. This mm-hmm. mind is the universe, and I really love it.
Yeah, this is very realistic thing, huh? Very practical thing. Universe or mind is real life, our life.
Mm-hmm. Quantum physicists are now seeing that the mind and the universe, the observer and the observed are the same. They affect each other. They're in a constant relationship.
There's a distinction between saying, where can all this information be stored versus where can all this information be processed?
Okay. Yeah, right.
In terms of the storage question, what quantum physics tells us, and particularly when you integrate that with systems theory, what you therefore realize is that you can store an infinite amount of information in an infinitely small space. And you can think about this, if you imagine, for example, that we're out in space and we're much tinier than a pinhead. And there's light coming from all directions, from all these distant galaxies, which contains information about billions and billions of stars, right? And all this information is crisscrossing through the universe. So everything's coming in all directions. It's all crisscrossing, all at the same time. And if you're in a tiny little spot, if you had spherical consciousness or spherical vision, you could be seeing the light coming from here, and the light coming from here, and the light coming from here, and the light coming from here. And all of it's crisscrossing. And the amazing thing is, all of that's going on all of the time, and none of it's getting distorted. In fact, photons literally can cross one another, and they may summate or they may cancel. We call it cancel out. They appear to summate or cancel, but after they've, quote, crossed each other, they go on as if nothing had happened. And if that wasn't the case, when we looked up at the sky at night, we would see mush, because all the photons would be interacting with all the other photons, right, and they would be just creating a complex, quote, mess. So instead, the universe appears to be designed to be able to have all this information from all these directions constantly mixing in every part of space simultaneously, and none of it gets mixed up. So if you think about that power, forgetting about how that happens, let's just say that it does happen. That's why you and I can look up at the sky at night and our little pupils are this big. We're seeing this gigantic vastness. All that star information is going into your pupil, it's going into my pupil, it's going on simultaneously. So all that holistic information is simultaneously present in every single spot. We take that idea, which is a fact, forgetting about how it works. And then what you do is you combine with the idea of a system. And a system is two or more things that are connected, and they're sending feedback, circulating information and energy back and forth. And through the interaction, the parts come together and the whole becomes, quote, greater than the sum of its parts. Hydrogen and oxygen come together, the two gases, they have feedback, they circulate energy and information, and what happens? We get a liquid called water which has all the unique properties of waterness. Now, what's common among every system, whether it's an electron and a proton in an atom, or whether it's two molecules coming together, or whether it's two strands of DNA, or two cells being the heart of the brain, or two people, or two planets, or two galaxies, it doesn't matter. If the components are sharing information and energy, and it's circulating, then what happens is that there is a storage process that takes place, and this storage process is also an evolving one. The take-home message, the way that this first came to me when I was a professor at Yale many years ago, is what goes around and stays around evolves around. Information that doesn't all disappear, not only is it preserved, but it could potentially grow because it can be influenced by the other things around it. Once you recognize that idea, then you realize that not only does everything at every level have, quote, memory, I call this systemic memory, but this memory is in a state of constant evolution. In fact, a prerequisite for learning itself is feedback. And we know that's the case. I mean, we know in daily life we want to learn, for example, shoot a basket or learn to play a musical instrument. We have to get feedback about whether we're making the right notes or whether we're getting the baskets and the ball. The feedback is what provides us with a corrective process. It's called negative feedback or positive feedback. Now, it turns out that feedback operates at every level, from the tiniest micro level to the most gigantic macro level, and every level in between. So you take the infinite nature of the storage of information in the vacuum of space with photons, and now you add systems operating with feedback loops at every single level, and all of a sudden you realize what we call a neural network of our brain, which makes our brain's capability for processing all this information. Imagine now that each of our individual brains are part of a much bigger brain, which happens to be on the Earth, and the Earth is part of a planetary brain, which becomes part of a solar system brain, that then becomes part of a galactic brain. And what I mean by brain here is a network of circulating feedback loops. Then what you realize is, at every level, you get this process of assimilation of ever more complex information. And if that boggles the mind, well, too bad. We just have to expand our minds to be able to see this.
So it's interesting to see that we have both Democrat and Republican presidents involved in different aspects of this Department of Peace movement that would actually be a U.S. Department of Peace. So actually, this current bill that's in Congress right now, H.R. 808, was written and first introduced by Congressman Dennis Kucinich from Ohio in July 11th, 2001. Which to me is very important to remember the date, because it was exactly 2 months before 9/11. And the legislation was written as a proactive, solution-oriented new department, tiny new department that would be at the table, sitting at the table with the president and all the different department heads, to actually be another tool for the president to decide if we have no other options, then perhaps we would have to go to war. But if we did have other options, a lot of those options would come from the Secretary of Peace. And so Congressman Kucinich introduced this bill in July of 2001. I heard about it in the newspaper. I wrote him a fan letter, and I said, "Dear Congressman Kucinich, thank you for introducing this legislation, which is incredible legislation. We were a country at peace, July 11th, 2001. We were fairly peaceful around the world." And I said, "You know, you and I are both from Cleveland. We're both raised Catholic. We're both short, and we're both vegetarian, although mm-hmm. he's vegan." So I said, "We have a lot in common. We both love peace." Mm-hmm. So he wrote me back a very nice letter thanking me for my interest. And then it wasn't until Marianne Williamson, who is now a friend of mine, had an email list in March of 2003, so about a year and a half later, Marianne invited anybody that would like to go to Washington to learn about this Department of Peace legislation, to learn how to go into our Senate and congressional offices on the Hill in Washington, and to have intelligent conversations with our elected representatives about creating a sister department, a new department, which would be this Department of Peace. And so I went to Washington with, there were six of us from Arizona, joined 200 people. So that was 4 years ago. So it was the United States working on creating a Department of Peace. And now here we are 4 years later in May of 2007, with 28 countries now around the world working to create departments of peace, with 50,000 grassroots volunteers around the country and the world that are networking with all kinds of groups, educating people about what the Department of Peace legislation is all about.